I think maybe Sharon's, which is the top one.
Yeah, there's a button over there.
And you face that way, because that's how.
Okay. I didn't mean to distract you from what you were doing, but when I saw you setting up on your laptop, I thought, well, I'm going to mention that I'm going to use that thing.
Good. I don't really know how to do it.
How are you?
How are you doing?
Good.
Come on.
Come on.
I'd like to call to order the Twin Falls City Council meeting for Monday, August 22nd. For those of you wishing to join us, please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. It might be my mic, so I'll try Greg's. All right, so welcome, everyone. I would confirm that we do have a quorum of the City Council. All seven members are here this evening. Mr. Rothweiler, do we have any amendments to the agenda?
Mr. Mayor, members of the Council, there are no amendments to this agenda. I do want to point out that you are working off an amended agenda. The amended agenda was published in time for the regular meeting, and therefore all of the items have been properly noticed, and there's no need for an official amended agenda or action taken by the City Council.
Thank you, Travis. Next on the agenda, we have Chris Toggenton.
Good man.
Okay. Next on the agenda, we have a proclamation this evening to congratulate Will Brown on his accomplishments and to commend his efforts as a member of the U.S. shooting team at the 21st Olympiad. So I'll read that. Whereas the games of the 21st Olympiad were held in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, August 5th through the 21st, 2016, and whereas Twin Falls native Will Brown, while demonstrating high skill in the field of marksmanship through national and international competition, qualified to represent the United States in the men's 10-meter and 50-meter air pistol events at those Olympic Games, and whereas Will Brown placed 12th and 10th in the world in those respective events, whereas Will's dedication to his sport and sportsmanship of the highest level have represented our country, state, community, and his family on a world stage. And whereas Will's participation in the Olympic Games assisted in achieving their mission to contribute to building a peaceful and better world by educating youth through sport practiced without discrimination of any kind and in the Olympic spirit, which requires mutual understanding with a spirit of friendship, solidarity, and fair play. Now, therefore, the City Council of the City of Twin Falls does hereby congratulate Will Brown on his accomplishments and commend his efforts as a member of the USA shooting team. Will, if you would come forward to accept this.
I just want to thank you all for the recognition and the support that you've given me throughout the last few weeks. It's a privilege and an honor to be able to represent my country, my state, my hometown at the Olympic Games. So I just want to say thank you.
Well, congratulations, Will. After that handshake, I will say I can see why you have a steady hand when you hold that pistol. But congratulations. I asked Will if he wasn't sticking around in Rio a little bit for a little more vacation while he was down there, but he quickly answered no. So I'll take that as you're happy to be home. So congratulations again, and thank you. Next on the agenda, we have general public input. If I could ask someone from staff to bring me the sign-up sheet, please. Thank you, Chief. So just a reminder of the public input procedures. The individuals wishing to provide public input this evening should be speaking on matters relevant to the City of Twin Falls. They'll wait to be recognized by the mayor. They'll approach the microphone and podium, state their name and address and whether they are a resident or property owner in the City of Twin Falls, and then proceed with their input. And we will limit input to 3 minutes per individual this evening. First, we have Ray Parrish. Welcome, Mr. Parrish.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My name is Ray Parrish. I live at 2572 Carousel Circle here in Twin. I am a property owner, and I come as the public affairs representative for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And I would like to invite each one of the council members to attend our dedicatory service out of the Bishop's Storehouse this coming Saturday at 10 o'clock. If I might approach all of you, I've got
you may.
Personal invites.
Thank you.
Thank you. The VIP is great. We have special seating for you. That's all I've got.
Thank you, Mr. Parrish. Don Hall.
Mr. Parrish.
Ray.
Mr. Parrish. Just want to let you know that we do have a Purple Heart dedication celebration that day, same time. So do you know how long? Because it starts at 11 at City Park.
The dedicatory will be done at 11. So
okay,
11
so we should be able to make both.
You should be able to make both.
Okay, we'll, thank you, sir.
We'll thanks do a little that running around for those.
All right.
So.
Thank you,
Ray. I appreciate it. And next on the sign-in sheet, we have Heather Stroop.
Good evening.
Welcome.
My name is Heather Stroop, and I live in Twin Falls County. I'm also a business owner in Twin Falls. And my my comments to this evening are a little bit on the order of a public service announcement. There is a group of people who would like to offer a civics class free of charge for anyone in the community who would like to attend, and it is we'd like to specifically invite refugees who might like to learn more about American Constitution and American laws. They're cordially invited to attend as well, and that is going to be this Thursday evening. That's August 25th, 7 p.m. It is at the at CSI in the Taylor Building, room 277, and free pocket constitutions will be given to anyone in attendance. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Heather. And next, Julie Ruff.
Good evening.
Welcome.
Julie Ruff, Twin Falls County, and property owner in Twin Falls. Tonight, I have a letter to read. I hope you'll receive that. It's from the family that we've talked so much about for the last couple of months, and these are her words. On June 2nd, my five-year-old daughter was a victim of a shocking crime that has caused a lot of public discussion both in Twin Falls and now nationally. About 10 days ago, Councilman Greg Lanting took to Facebook and made a number of claims about the case and my family that he has now admitted were not true. This past Tuesday, Mr. Lanting personally visited my family to apologize. He was very sincere and admitted that he was wrong. I believe he meant it with his heart. Thank you for that. He also gave us $100 just to help our family. We thank Mr. Lanting for that, but my family has decided that we are not comfortable accepting this money for ourselves. Instead, we have decided to use his donation of $100 to start a fund for local families of victims, those who need help, just like our family did. We will also be adding $100 of our own money to match what Mr. Lanting has given. Unfortunately, our experience with victim services in Twin Falls shows that they do not provide the help that victims need in a timely manner. Our own application for victim services has still not yet been approved. Without the generous help from our community, we would still live in the apartment complex where the crime against our daughter occurred. We will have more specific details about the fund and how people can contribute in the coming weeks. Thank you, everyone, for your help. Our family is in a home now. Our daughter is happy, feels safe, and we can finally begin to heal. Sincerely, that family. Thank you.
Thank you. Lee Stranahan.
Good Good evening, everyone. My name's Lee Stranahan. I'm, in theory, a resident of Dallas, Texas, but it sure seems like I live in Twin Falls now. I wanted to take, I'm the lead investigative reporter for Breitbart News, and I wanted to take a moment to urge the city council and the residents of Twin Falls to not trust me. And I think this is a very important principle. I've been reporting on Twin Falls for a couple of weeks, and we have a number of really important reports coming up in the next 2 weeks that talk about the general issues, not just the refugee program that's been controversial here, but the other issues that caused it. And I think it's very important as both a member of the media and a consumer of the media that people not take the media's word on anything. I found myself in the interesting position this weekend of being the subject of an editorial by the Times News. And it was interesting, and I think people should read the Times News. I think people should read all media sources. I personally listen to media sources on the left. I listen to media sources on the right. I like the system that they have in England, where they don't pretend to be objective. They don't pretend to be unbiased. What they do is the Guardian is on the left, for instance, in the UK. The Daily Mail's on the right. Everybody can read that and make up their own mind. And I work for Breitbart News. We're a proudly pro-American, we're in favor of immigration laws being enforced, and we're very anti-establishment. That's who we are. We were characterized as xenophobic by the Times News. That's bias, right? But I, like I say, I urge people to read what I have to say. My work should be judged whether it's factual or not, and I urge people always to click the links. So, and I urge you, the members of the City Council, also to hold yourself to that standard. I don't think there's anything wrong with being an activist. I think there's something wrong with being inactive. I don't think there's anything wrong with being politically involved. I think there is something wrong with being dishonest, and I think none of my reporting has been dishonest. When Mr. Lanting apologized personally to the family, for instance, we posted that right away. We posted it just as it was, and that's what we'll continue to do. So there are important issues here that concern Twin Falls. I don't feel enough light has been shed on some of them. That's fine. And I hope that the residents of Twin Falls and you and the City Council take a look at what we report, check its veracity, make up your own minds. And once again, I invite anyone from the City Council, especially the mayor, if you'd like to be interviewed, we will do the interview straight. We will put the entire interview on so people can see we're not doing anything funny with cutting it. And I just would also like to thank everyone in Twin Falls. I've really enjoyed my time here so far, and I really enjoyed my time in the city. It's obviously beautiful and a lot of great people. So thanks very much for your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stranahan. John Capillaris. Welcome, John.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. I'm John Capillaris, 1231 Sunburst Street. I'm also the Xavier Charter School Board Chair. This afternoon, the part of North College between Field Stream and Creekside Way was paved. Almost a year ago, I presented a petition to the city asking for a bike lane on North College. And here's the motion that was made. I quote, "Council Member Talkington moved to place bike lanes between Grandview and Creekside Way. The motion was seconded by Vice Mayor Hawkins. Roll call vote showed all members present voted in favor of the motion. Approved 7-0. So not only did the city paint a bike lane, but also painted lines for cars. And that was very important. This improved public safety in the neighborhood, and we are very grateful. If the lines are extended, as stated in the motion to Creekside Way, because now they only go to Field Stream, I believe that this will add to community safety in our neighborhood. Our school year begins after Labor Day on the 6th of September. And I hope that the city will act before then because we'd like to have everything in place when all that traffic comes back for the school year. So what I'm asking is that the bike lane be extended from Field Stream to Creekside Way as in the original motion. And I hope that the city will stand with the Xavier community in promoting public safety. Thank you.
Thank you, John. And we will make sure that staff takes a look at that before school get started. Travis, do you have a comment on that? Okay, thank you. So that's all that we had sign up. So is there anyone else in the audience that wishes to address the council in the public input session on something that is not on the agenda? If so, you're welcome to come forward now. Seeing no one, we will move on with the balance of our business. Next is the consent calendar. Chris Talkington.
Move approval of the consent calendar.
Second.
Hold on, I have to get to the right spot in my book. The motion by Chris Talkington, seconded by Don Hall, to approve the consent calendar. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Sean Berriger?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Don Hall?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-2-0. Under items for consideration, first we have a presentation to announce and personally invite the City Council and all citizens of Twin Falls to a Purple Heart dedication ceremony to be held in City Park on Saturday, August 27th, 10 a.m. until noon. We have Tammy Billman and John Caton. Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor and Council. So, as you may recall, on May 2nd, the City of Twin Falls passed a resolution declaring itself a Purple Heart City. A Purple Heart City honors the sacrifices of those who have served our nation, and specifically those that were wounded or killed in action. The City Street Department will be placing a Purple Heart sign at the five entrances to the city and one at the new City Hall building currently under construction. And I wanted to tell a quick story about Tammy Billman and how she got involved with this. Her husband works for the street department. She saw the signs in the shop, and one day she came in and she said, "What's that?" And being an avid veteran supporter, we explained to her, you know, we had a proclamation, now we're going to go out and put these at the entrances. And she was like, "Oh, no, you're not. That's not all you're going to do. We got to do a celebration." So really, that she was inspired by this, and she has organized all of this. She asked me for a little bit of support. I've done very little. She's done all the outreach. I know she's been in touch with Councilman Hall and Mayor Berger and lots of other people. She's had this beautiful advertisement put together, as you can see, and I want to let her talk a little bit about the ceremony this Saturday.
And actually, about an hour ago, this became real, and now I'm like, holy crud. Now I'm nervous. I haven't been nervous this entire time, and now I'm nervous. But this is going to happen on Saturday. I'm so excited. I'm so excited. I've had wonderful people, absolutely wonderful, fantastic people helping with this. And John has helped more than he really knows or realizes. Shane Hall from Slave Dragon put together this beautiful poster that advertises on the 27th of this month that we will be doing this from 10 until noon, 10 o'clock till 11. We will have free refreshments, coffee, cookies, just kind of a meet and greet so people can come down and meet some of the veterans and some of our local soldiers if they happen to be there. And some of our council people, if you can make it. Apparently we do have another thing going on that day. But if you can make it and kind of dance between the two invitations, that would be great. And I know that some people are going to be out of town. That's okay. Families are important too. But, you know, and if we can, you know, people from the community, as many people as we can get. But, you know, anybody that can come down, it would be wonderful. We are going to start with, you know, we're going to have benediction, we're going to have a national anthem, we're going to have the MIA POW group is going to have all of their flags there. We're going to have flags from every war or conflict that has taken place. 21, if I'm correct, Am I correct, Mr. Talkington?
Well, I wasn't alive for all of them. But
I hope not. I hope not, because well, if so, I'm going to go get you a walker.
He missed it.
But
for most of them, she says.
A 19.
But I'm thinking that you would have knowledge of a few of them. But I'm thinking 21 would be the overall.
Boy, that's amazing.
But anyway, they're going to have all of their flags on stage, so I think that will be a beautiful sight to see for anyone. And we will have a 21-gun salute. We will follow up with taps. It will just be beautiful, so I hope everybody can come see it. I'm so excited about it. And I could go on and on and on. Like I said, I'm nervous. It just about an hour ago dawned on me that this is really going to happen. So I'm so excited. So please, everybody, come. And we are going to have the 116th there. They are going to be there. They're going to have a couple of their vehicles down there. Not tanks. They're not bringing tanks. So don't come down and expect to see a tank there, because I did tell Captain Edwards, no tanks. So we're not going to have any tanks, but we are going to have a couple of vehicles. So if you can
great.
Come down.
Thank you, Tammy. Thank
and I
you.
I do expect you to be there.
I'll be there.
You better be.
I will be
You're
there.
Talking.
I'll be busy on Saturday, but
yes.
That's all good. Now, Tammy, okay. Thank you for your dedication and all the work that you put into bringing this event together. And, you know, nerves are good. That makes sure that things are going to get done. But I promise it'll be a fantastic event, and I appreciate all that you've done for it.
Thank you.
Next on the agenda, we have a request from the Historic Preservation Commission for permission to apply for a $2,000 community enhancement grant from the Idaho State Historical Society. And we have Nancy Taylor from our Historic Preservation Commission. Welcome,
Mayor, Nancy. Council. I am chair of our city's Historic Preservation Commission. And it's time that we reprint our brochures, which you all know about. They need to be updated, first of all, and we are willing to do that. There's a couple of things that we're going to include in the new brochures. It will be the first practical use of our quick response. You know, the little things you see on everything that you can put your smart. See, I'm.
QR codes.
QR codes, the little things that are there, which will allow people who have our brochures to go to another level and learn about our city's history and our preservation efforts. The original brochures were a joint venture between the HPC and the Chamber of Commerce, and we were very proud of that partnership. We are asking the Idaho State Historical Society for $2,000 to reprint our brochures. We're down to just a few. And we do give them away. They're on display at the chamber. They're on display at City Hall. We take them to events. Anyone, schools, anyone that would like a copies, we take them. A brief proposal is $2,000 we need. And we need your endorsement and approval. And we need the mayor's signature on our paperwork. And we will submit it and further our work to preserve our heritage in Twin Falls.
Chris Talkington.
But Nancy, as I understand, that 2,000 request is a service by city. It's not actual dollars for our match, or are you requesting 2,000 and
it's 2,000 to print the brochure, standard printing.
Okay,
them.
So it's not an in-kind service. It's actual
no.
hard dollars.
Yes.
Well, the request is for the request.
Yeah.
From the historical,
yeah, it's a
historic
volunteer
society
match.
Is cash. The match is in kind.
Yes.
And will you be able to include anything in our North 5 points, or will that become an addendum or an update after this?
We could certainly include that. We haven't really discussed that yet, but
might
we
be
can
a few
certainly.
Months away, is the,
yeah, we can certainly consider that, because that'll be a wonderful project to
thank you.
To enhance our efforts.
Mayor Berger, I move that we approve the request of the Historic Preservation Commission to apply for a $2,000 community enhancement grant from the Idaho State Historical Society.
I second that.
I'm going to give that one to Nikki Boyd.
Good.
She actually flicked her light on. So.
She was really quick on
that. I have a motion by Greg Lanting, seconded by Nikki Boyd, to approve the request to apply for the funds. Is there any further discussion from the council? Seeing none, Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Sean Berger?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Don Hall?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0.
I have signed my part in it. We need the mayor's signature, if I may approach the bench.
You bet. I'll sign it super quick for you. Come on up.
Is this oh, I thought it was Judge D.
I have the little spots marked for me. Is that the only place I need to sign? Is this the letter? Oh, okay.
Thank you so much.
Perfect. Thank you, Nancy. Next on the agenda is a report of staff findings and recommendations for electronic sign. And we have Kathy Marcus with our information services. Welcome, Kathy.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. So you had directed staff to come back with some alternatives to hanging banners downtown. And so we created a committee or a parallel team to come up with some options. And you'll see on the board the list of the members of the parallel team. It was Travis Rothweiler, Craig Kingsbury, Josh Palmer, Kathy Marcus, Mitch Humble, and Wendy Davis. This team got together and reviewed the different types of advertising or signs that we could put and where we could put the different kinds of signs. And the team agreed that an electronic sign would be visually more appealing in the long term and more cost effective than banners. And these are just some pictures of some of the banner suggestions where you could have multiple banners at one location or the A-frame banners, and we were trying to find a way to keep the banners from flying away and still make them look nice. It was determined that an electronic sign would probably be more effective than a banner. It kind of could change the message, change the nature of the messages. Instead of just a one firm event, we can do short reminders of city events and critical news items, and also any emergency notifications that we need would be easier to post on an electronic sign. Several locations were considered for an electronic sign. Blue Lakes, Five Points, the parks at Shoshone, near the visitor center, Jim's gas station, other city parks were all considered. Five Points West and Five Points South, Falls and Blue Lakes, the Parks and Recreation dirt lot, and highway and any highway district type signs. So those are the signs that kind of hang over the street, like you see up on 93 coming into Twin. We had an initial design of a sign with two-sided message. This sign was what we were thinking of putting in a park or one of the other locations. The cost of this sign for two-sided was based on the size of the sign. It was $68,663 for a 9x20 or $51,000 for an 8x17-inch sign. We thought this was a good idea at first. We decided the Five Points location would be the most cost-effective and would improve visibility if we put it there. Mitch Humble presented this to the Arts Subcommittee. There's a large art project that's going to be going into the Five Points location, and the Subcommittee is not interested at this time in having electronic sign at that location. And after reviewing the art project and the space, the sign committee was in agreement that they weren't really compatible projects. So we came up with another plan. The preferred option that we have right now is an archway, preferably over Shoshone, with an electronic banner attached to the archway. So we would have the option to put messages on this banner, and, or this, sorry, this archway or gateway, some people call it. And these are samples of some of the entrances that we looked at. Ours would have a reader board, but none of these had a reader board on them. The location that we determined would probably be the best is where the little circles are on this map. It's right across from the Rose Garden. There's a little piece of white concrete that stands out, and it would be the perfect location for crossing the highway at the, or the roadway at that location. We're currently estimating that the project will cost $150,000 plus. We believe that we'll be able to do some fundraising to raise money for this sign. There's been several individuals who have already approached us in favor of the sign, and we included letters in your packets from some of those individuals. A lot of people are feeling like they aren't getting enough information about what is actually going on at the parks and in the city, and we believe that this electronic sign will give us the opportunity to quickly change messages, add messages, and get the word out to those people who just don't have access to any other means of getting the information. This is a picture that, or a photo of a drawing that was created by Lytle Signs. It's by no means the final project. It was just a, what something would look like. And as you can see, we had talked about possibly having the pillars be rock to tie into the stage area that's right behind it. And then we had Welcome to Historic Downtown Twin Falls, but some people are not in favor of the down of that wording. So if this is approved, of course, it'll go before and it'll have a lot of design before it's actually created. And I'm sure you'll see that. Do you have any questions for me?
Chris Talkington.
I believe Shoshone is a state highway. Is yes. It not? 70,
it is not.
74, 79?
Not there. It's 74 ends in second.
Oh, it does. Okay, so there's no conflict of having to get approval of other authorities then?
We would have to get the county's approval for
right.
That side of the property by the Rose Garden.
Thank you.
Travis Rothweiler.
So although it's not part of the state highway system and there wouldn't necessarily be an approval through ITD, I think it's important to recognize that that part of Shoshone is still part of a informal truck route where you see vehicles traveling up and down the road. And so whatever design is, I guess the first step is if this is something that the council is intrigued with us continuing to move forward, then we'll continue to do that. If this is something that the council says this is a non-starter, then we won't continue to waste our time to talk with other people about designs and getting actual costs and understanding what height limitations may be moving forward with other traffic that might be flowing inside of that area. But the idea tonight was to present the concept that Kathy has done to see if we're on anywhere close to a right path, and if we are, we'll continue to proceed forward, and if we're not, we'll go back to square one.
And due to the cost, it would have to go before an RFP.
Okay. Don Hall?
You know, I like the concept. I like the location. It's a chunk of change that gave me pause, but I expected it to be that expensive if we're talking about going clear across the road. I think it's a great communication device. I'm assuming then we'll have some sort of, if we proceeded and we did this eventually, we would have some sort of procedures and policies of what kind of advertisements and or public messages would be attached. And has there been any talk or any, is there any desire to charge to try to recoup some of the costs of the actual sign for different events? Have we talked about that at all?
We have discussed that a little bit. We've had different options and conversations. We had talked about maybe for fundraising, if we had nonprofits that wanted to donate, we can give them free sign advertising for a certain amount of time. But we didn't get too far into it. We were just thinking of ideas. But, yes, recouping the cost was one of them.
Thank you.
Travis?
We've also had individuals, I think Kathy shared this, we've had individuals approach us who have heard about this idea and this opportunity since publishing the agenda and are actually excited and want to help us raise the funds through a public outreach and public donation process to help kind of create the money needed to move this forward. And if this is something that is well received, I mean, if we're going to think longer term, there really, as we're looking at the downtown project and we're looking at expanding that downtown project, and you're aware of Jackie approaching us at ultimately trying to do something different with the seconds and approaching and getting dollars to do the 6th and Minidoka connection. We're trying to expand that footprint of what is downtown, and the definitions involve just Main Avenue. Some involve a larger geographic area, and so the thought was, if this is successful, could you anchor it on two ends? Could you put a second welcome to historic downtown on the other side as you're entering in at some later date in time, so that the messaging is consistent, but you're also impacting and reaching more people? So just kind of where the committee was, that if this is something that was successful, we could raise significant funds to be able to construct two signs or one sign, with the idea of creating a second sign at some point in the later future.
Did you have something further, Don?
I'll wait.
Okay. Chris Hawkins.
Well, I really like the idea of having a community fundraising component of this. Don't believe it should be just tax dollars, and whatever it amounts to be, 10 or 20 or 50% of the ultimate cost, I think, will be more than borne out by this is part of our community, and we help put the thing up, so to speak. You did a good job of visualizing this, and I love the location, like Don. I think it's a perfect one. I do not like the word historic. That's an overused word, and what would be the opposite of saying it's not historic, an unhistoric area? I mean, it speaks for itself. I do draw the line on having a for-profit type of signage. I don't want to have used cars or furniture being sold in the gateway to Twin Falls. Other than that, full speed ahead. It's a wonderful idea.
Greg Lansing.
I was going to bring up the part that Chris didn't like, and I didn't have in my mind advertisements, I guess. I've worked for 33 years in Filer, and Filer has a reader board that they charge for, but it's not for advertisements. It's for, they charge groups to promote their event, or maybe even somebody's birthday, or whatever they want to do on the sign, and they use it to pay for the maintenance of the sign. That's the purpose of them collecting money. It's not to make money. It's to just hold the Filer's taxpayers harmless. In other words, as far as, because a reader board, you see them around town, you know there's always issues. There's going to be costs associated with maintaining it, and that's what they use it for. But I wasn't, in my mind, I didn't think used cars. So I guess I was looking at different
ones.
Yeah. Or even new ones, yeah.
Don Hall?
I was just going to add, I like the idea of emergency messages. We could have amber alerts be put on there instantaneously if there's some sort of a issue within the city, a safety concern. I really like that. It's a good communication piece. So,
well, I would add that I do think it's a good location and a good kind of concept. One thing I might suggest is they're looking at different design options. So I know that electronic message boards have come a long way, and they're practically like televisions. However, I don't wonder if that's maybe overkill of what we're trying to do. So, you know, I think about like the ticker tape thing that it ran around Times Square. So something that's longer, that, like, takes up the entire sign, and you can put more information, almost feeling more like the banners that we have now of get the information on there, as opposed to a lot of moving and colorful activity that you know, may or may not be aesthetically pleasing. Might be good to look at options of what that might look like compared to the, you know, rolling video waving American flag background that we see on all the other ones. Greg Lansing,
we're
sharing our microphone. So,
yes. Can we have Mitch discuss what the rules are for reader boards in Twin Falls? Because we do have rules concerning exactly what you're talking about, even though I see some of them kind of on the edge of that a lot.
So, I guess just right off the bat, let me just start by saying this will take some special approval by the council. This won't meet the rules in a lot of ways. In some ways, we can still do that, but it's a sign in a right-of-way, for one, and typically that's something we would tend to avoid. The message center likely is going to be larger than what our code would allow. I think it's a 50-square-foot limit. And so some of these things we're going to have to take through a different kind of a process to get done. Having said that, we do have some rules for message centers, and brightness is one of those things, and how often the message can circulate is one of those things. And in addition to that, the National, I'm going to get this wrong, Highway Traffic Safety Commission, I think is the the group. They have some additional rules that, not really rules, but the recommendations, and I would think where the city's going to have a sign that we might want to try and follow a higher standard maybe than our rules, which are a little bit more restrictive. But yeah, they all deal with brightness and how often the message cycles, and we don't allow full motion video anyway. I know there's a lot of signs out in town that can show a video, and they're artificially limiting them to meet our code. So I don't know why we'd want to pay for the more expensive sign that can do that when we wouldn't do that anyway. The brightness is actually one of the biggest ones, is how bright they go. They can actually get quite a bit brighter than what our code allows. So that's what I do. Oh, the other thing is the messages that are displayed. So we wouldn't want to sell cars or Coca-Cola or whatever, because unless you're selling that on site, then that's also a violation of city code. So we would advertise community events. City communication kind of type uses is what I envision on here, is us saying, you know, come sign your kid up for soccer, or come to the city council meeting tonight, or those kinds of things, as well as Western Days is this weekend right here at City Park. So special events, city communication kind of stuff. That kind of sign is not necessarily restricted to on-site only, and so that would be another way to comply with the code. And still use this kind of a sign.
Thank you, Mitch. Ruth Pierce.
I just want to say I appreciate having an alternative. I like, the fact that we have an option that replaces the banners, because that's huge. We've had a lot of feedback on that. Secondly, I think the communication part from the city is really important. It puts it out there quicker than somebody just going on to the website and trying to find out when garbage cans have to be brought in or something like that. But I really like the idea. Of course, the numbers person in me wants fine-tuned numbers, which I'm sure you'll be looking at different options. And not to forget the maintenance, estimated maintenance would be important as well.
Thank you. Any other comments from the council?
I suppose the most united on the position I've seen the council in a while. What do you think, a year to get the thing up?
So I think next steps, what we want to do is we obviously want to, there's going to be lots of individuals who probably have a need to be a part of the conversation. You know, just looking over, we have Nancy and the members of the Historic Preservation Committee. The commission that would really probably want to be a part of that. I'm sure members of the city council will want to be part of that. And so what we'll do is we'll devise a strategy that kind of creates an opportunity for interested parties to have representatives to help us now go through some level of design. And once we have that level of design and some design options, we can then get those priced. From an estimate, not only for construction, but what is the cost to maintain that on an annual basis. We'll follow that up with a subsequent presentation to the council. And then from there, we'll take your guidance and make whatever tweaks we need to make, or we'll then begin the process to include that in some sort of budgetary process or use other financial means that we have available to construct the sign.
Suzanne Hawkins.
Thank you. I think this question might be for Josh. Do we have access to something like SurveyMonkey or something where we could throw it out there with you know, like different choices for designs for the general public to weigh in without having to try to get open houses or get people in one location, but yep. maybe where they could weigh in from home easier?
Yeah, we have a few different options we can choose from, but we can certainly do that.
I would think there's going to be a lot of opinions on what this should and shouldn't look like and what it should and shouldn't say, and I would just be curious for a broader opinion from our citizens. Thank you.
All right. Kathy, thank you so much. Oh, Nikki Boyd.
I do have a question. It might be for Travis. If we discuss this, it's on a list as part of that. Are we discussing it only as it stays on this list, or are we discussing this as we agree this is a good idea and we're removing it from that and moving forward as a separate project?
So with a funding source, the ability to stand the sign would occur sooner. If you're going to wait through a process that you dedicate a funding source through the next budgetary process, we can guarantee that it would be after October. We also have the ability to use cash reserves. If that's something the council wanted to do, we could have a conversation about that. Right now, the timeline is fairly uncertain, and I can't guarantee you how fast we can move through a design process and then ultimately going through a bid process to be into a position of constructing that over the course of the next few months. It might be something that we can target for fiscal year 18 construction. Knowing that, it's important to recognize that with the hard stop that we've put on the banners that's going to occur later this fall, there will be a extended period of time where there's no banner and no reader board.
Don Hall?
Have we contacted the county at all to at least tell them that we're looking at this, just give them a heads up?
No, we were trying to get your opinion first.
Okay.
So
yep.
Now that we have that, we can move forward.
Okay. We might want to reach out to them. I don't know, because if they read it in the paper the next day, they're like, well, were you going to talk to us? and what are the dynamics there? Is it on their property or is it in the right of way? How does all that work?
We don't know for certain yet. I believe it's the right of way. The picture that they drew was actually on the property that Lytle Signs had drawn, but that wasn't what we had envisioned. We had envisioned in that little sidewalk area that it's the grass area right next to the road.
Okay. There's going to be some design issues we'll have to get through. So there's a sidewalk there, and the sidewalk's in the right of way. So do you span the sidewalk with the sign, and then you're on the county's property, or do you come inside the sidewalk and between the sidewalk and the curb, and then maybe you're too close to the roadway with kind of a hard wall? And I suspect that we'll be on the outside of the sidewalk on not private property, on the county property, and then the outside of the sidewalk on the park property, and we'll probably need to have a partnership with the county.
I would just add that it's always nice to feel like you're part of the process instead of, oh, by the way, we've already been talking about this for 6 months. I would probably reach out to them sooner rather than later.
I could give them a call tomorrow.
Any other comments from the council? Kathy, thank you so much for the presentation and the hard work of the group. Next is a presentation regarding the value of the One City Employee Training by the University of Virginia. And we have a whole lot of presenters here, but we'll start with Deputy City Manager Mitch Humble.
So during this budget process, we had a question asked when we talked about the training budget for the city manager's office. And there's another chunk of money this year for more One City training, and it's, I want to say, $40,000 what we have in there this year. And the question was, I think it's a valid question, but the question was basically, what's the citizens going to get out of that expense? For the fourth year in a row now, what are the citizens going to get from that expense? And so if you'll remember that night a few weeks ago, Travis said probably the best way to answer that would not be for he or for I or Brian to answer that, but rather to have some of the employees who've been through that training answer that for you. And so we've kind of put together a little presentation tonight with several of our team to come talk to you about that. I'll just lay the groundwork a little bit and say that we've had 80 city employees go through some level of this one city training, whether that be the two-week program in Virginia or the one-week program in Virginia or the 3 or 4 day program that we've had them come out here a couple of times. We've had 80 different people go through that program and are familiar with it and working on implementing it. A lot of supervisors and a lot of frontline employees are in that 80. We have another 13 or 14 or so supervisors that have not yet been through the training, and some of their employees have. And it's kind of a interesting dynamic you have there. But that also means that we've got almost 200 city employees that haven't been through the training at all and that have heard the words thrown around one city, and they've heard things like parallel teams and all the stuff that's coming out of the training, but they haven't really been exposed to that as directly as those 80 or so have. And so that's part of it. We're trying to change an organizational culture here, and that's not a small thing. That's kind of a big task that we have ahead of us. We're trying to create, or not create, but we're trying to help our employees be more satisfied with their work and more engaged in their work. And when they are those things, they'll stay longer. They'll help us attract more employees. So it's really a recruitment, a retention kind of a thing we're building here too. We also know that those satisfied and engaged employees are more productive, they're happier, they're more innovative, they're more efficient. And those are all kind of things that we're looking for. But what I want to do is now turn the time over to some of our employees so they can tell you some stories about efficient and happy and productive employees and what we're actually seeing come out of this training. We're going to lead with Aaron Hudson from our fire department. He's going to get up and talk to you. I'm just going to lay it all out so I don't have to be up here every time in between. Following Aaron, Gretchen, Scott's going to come up, and Jason. Are you guys coming together or one at a time? Together. Gretchen and Jason are going to come up. Jason Brown from engineering, Gretchen from HR. Following those two, Sean Shropshire from our water department is going to come up and talk to you. And following Sean, we'll have Craig Kingsbury. And then closing us out will be Mandy Thompson in the city manager's office. So I'll turn it over to them.
Welcome, Aaron.
Thank you.
You're awfully dressed up.
I dress appropriately for the occasion.
We were also commenting on your high and tight haircut. No. Hoorah.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. It helps with the masks. Also. First of all, thank you for allowing me to come talk to you about One City and the different benefits that it brings for us as employees. I've had the opportunity to be part of a parallel team to discuss values with our whole employee group. I've also had the opportunity to be through the training both as a student and as a mentor. There's a tremendous amount of information and philosophy change and cultural change that can come from the teachings, from this information that we've received. Being a part of this parallel team has been a really unique experience for me. I've been with the city for a little over 21 years, and in my time, anytime a committee gets brought up, it's usually within a specific department. So for the fire department, it's an apparatus specification committee made up of firefighters, and that's how we do business. For the most part, that's how a lot of our individual groups within the city have done business, the individual departments. So this is kind of a different way of us to be able to do business. My parallel team is made up of J.P. O'Donnell from the police department. Dan Lewin was part of it up until he retired. He was also with the police department. Katie Touche from human resources. Josh Baird from engineering. So each one of us brings kind of a unique perspective, a different level of experience, training, background, and we were tasked with going to the entire city employee group and talking to them about values. That process seemed really daunting at first. Again, with that diverse group that we had as part of our parallel team, Josh Baird, as the engineering mind, was able to step up and say, oh, that's not going to be a problem at all. Perfect. You get to schedule the meetings. And he took care of that, and it worked out great. We were able to, in a very short timeline, be able to discuss and have conversations with all of our city employees, give every single person that works for the city of Twin Falls an opportunity to talk to our group about values. The feedback that we received was also really interesting. A lot of people had not had that opportunity. Not only had they not had this group of outsiders, if you will, outside of their department, outside of their normal work groups, come in and speak with them, but then the opportunity to speak their mind and discuss any issues that they want, discuss the values that they hope to see that all of the city employees follow going forward. We held all of our meetings. We as a parallel team got together. We narrowed all the terminology down. We had pages and notebooks full of information from all of these meetings that we conducted and from all these employee groups. We narrowed the information down, and then at the One City Retreat, we had several options for all the employees to vote on. From those options, the employee group picked the top five, and we're continuing to narrow those down. We actually have the top five values set at this point. And being part of this process and being able to communicate with all the city employees was a really educational experience. It makes for more opportunity, it makes for more engagement, and it allows people to have their voices be heard where maybe they didn't feel that their voices were heard in the past, or maybe they didn't have those opportunities to have their voices heard in the past. Any questions for me?
Thank you, Aaron. Any questions?
I don't see any. All
right. Thank you.
So good evening, Council. We're here to talk to you a little bit today about what we have been using in our organization that's part of also One City, as well as a way that we're incorporating that in other training opportunities. So many of you might have heard through business trainings, Myers-Briggs Type Indicator, or MBTI. So part of the high performance organization includes a strong focus and emphasis on communication. And Myers-Briggs has been described often as the ability to talk in two languages. So how some people take in information, kind of information that they trust, the way that they judge situations and the way that they would evaluate problems can be completely opposite. And Myers-Briggs helps build a bridge between those polar opposites. So one of the things that we did was this past January, I got to go to a training to become a certified MBTI practitioner. And so we're going to do a little exercise. So this will be fun. Do you all have a piece of paper and a pen that you could jot a note on? Feel free to play along in the audience if you'd like.
Would you like a piece of paper?
I would like a piece of paper. I thought the back of this might have something.
Yeah.
It's color above the back, too.
Are you grading on the curve, Gretchen?
Absolutely. All right, so I'm going to put down a picture, and what I want you to do is to look at the picture for 30 seconds without making any comments. Any comments? And then I want you to jot down a list of what you saw and record your observations, and I'll give you another 30 to 45 seconds afterwards, and then we're going to talk about what you wrote down. Okay. Okay. Yep. Start the clock. Okay, we'll take down the picture, and we'd like you to jot down a list of what you saw and record your observations. about 10 more seconds. Okay. So, without putting you on the spot, does anybody want to share one a couple of things? You don't have to repeat if somebody else says what you saw as well, but add something new as we go through, just a couple of comments.
For some reason, I fixated on the birds and the fish hanging in the background. That was seemed out of place to me, so that grabbed my attention.
Okay.
And the snail. Don't forget the snail.
I did not see a snail.
So I go right to the words and read the Jack Be Nimble, Jack Be Quick first, and then the eyes of the puppet master, like, really drew me in. So.
Puppet master had 10 fingers controlling Jack and Jill, who faced slightly to the right. He was wearing a maroon red coat. He had blue eyes, and they were jumping over the flame.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Other things? Other observations?
The 3-2 perspective on the picture.
So it had a nursery rhyme going around the edge that was instantly recognizable, so perhaps a preconceived idea came to your mind of what you thought that was. But the thing that I noticed the most was Jack had a leg extended as if he wanted to perhaps try to jump over the candlestick, but the puppet master was definitely controlling what he could do.
Okay. All right, so I'll stop you there because you've already identified the two dichotomies of the middle pairing of Myers-Briggs, which are sensing and intuition. Mm-hmm. So people with a preference for sensing will describe literally what they see. Chris described literally what he saw, physical attributes of the picture, colors, shapes, and then they try to make sense out of the shapes that they see. So why were the fish and the birds there? Was it, is it just because it's more puppets? Was there more story to tell? Was it 10 fingers? Was it 9? Was there a snail in the picture? Okay, those are sensing reactions. People with a preference for intuition will say they'll interpret the picture. They'll sense possibilities that are in it. They'll connect meanings to the things that are in it. They may make up a story that explains what it is about the picture and why it is and how you have an emotional reaction to it, or maybe it draws you some way. Some people see that picture as very sinister. Other people see it as a child's nursery rhyme, but they can connect meaning to it. So what can you conclude about this kind of thing? So when you talk about using Myers-Briggs and this kind of an example as an organization, what is drawn out is that we can all look at the same thing and come out with completely different observations, big pictures, end of story, details, all of those pieces. We have to remember that each of us trust our own perception of what we saw. If one person saw it as negative or menacing, but the other person saw it as fantasy and childlike, both of them absolutely believe what they saw, and both of those are totally opposite. Okay? So when you think about that from a perception of an organization, why should we care? So educating about the way that those things occur and about different perceptives, gain insight to personality. So it allows people to look at their team members, their people within their department, their supervisors, and to identify some of the ways that they look at certain things, and then be able to kind of phrase how they would respond or provide information accordingly. As a staff benefit, it helps you appreciate others. It helps you grow your own skill set in order to do things not only how you would, but maybe how your teammate needs to see it in order to get consensus, in order to move them forward. It also allows us to respect different preferences. It's important that as we talk about the values of our organization, that one of those that that we talk about acceptance and connectivity, that it's not just me versus you, but that we build those bridges between them. So there are four dichotomies: extrovert and introvert, sensing and intuition, thinking and feeling, judging and perceiving. And the ideal leader in our organization is an extrovert, they're action-oriented, is an introvert, they're contemplative, is sensing, they're pragmatic, is intuitive, they're a visionary, is thinking, they're logical, is feeling, they're compassionate, is judging, they're planful, and is perceiving, they're adaptable. There is no perfect set of those. All of them are important, and that's why it's important that we educate and make sure people know what those are.
So my part in this is, as I thought about the Myers-Briggs, I never really even knew what Myers-Briggs was before I came to the city. Whether that was I just didn't have the knowledge or I wasn't paying attention, which is unusual to my personality type. So, but this, you know, on a personal note, this really has affected me in the sense of when I came to the city, there was some personal life situations that were happening, and as oftentimes as life situations correspond, you start learning, you get a little bit more involved, and so as this opportunity was presented, it was something that I grabbed a hold of, just to find out and discover a little bit more about myself and the type of person that I was or I am. And also, the benefit to me is you can understand the pitfalls, or what your personality may lead you into as a pitfall, but also what your strengths are as a personality. And looking at it as a whole organization and finding those people that thrive in certain situations and those people that thrive in other situations, and amplifying the workforce that we have here at the city. And so grabbing a hold of this, I actually took it Thanksgiving and subjected my family members to it. And so now, you know, now the engineering side of me starts coming out and wanting to look at how I interact with people and how I affect other people and those types of relationships and how to better communicate with those people. And so I've seen it not only in the work group that I work with, but also looking at community members and the situations that we're involved in. And particularly in my job as environmental engineer, trying to figure out how to better position the city, but also understand that other people have different opinions and different thoughts and ideologies, and being able to amplify those and pick up on those and recognize those has been a great benefit to me as we've gone through the last few years of understanding this. And so, you know, it's been a personal gratification for me because I've understood who I am a little bit better. But I also get to understand who the people I work with on a daily basis are.
So we're using Myers-Briggs. So this week we're doing it for the first time in the new employee orientation. So all of our new employees that have been hired essentially since October 1st of this fiscal year, the first group will go through and do the Myers-Briggs training, and they'll have the opportunity to participate in that. And then we'll do a second training in about a month for the rest of the group that we haven't picked up yet. Myers-Briggs can be used in a lot of different ways. They can help resolve conflict within teams. They can help broaden people as far as their acceptance of other people. It can help in developing of leadership styles. It's not to say this is the best engineer because it's this type, and it's not meant to pigeonhole or to say that people can only do certain things. And in fact, there are lots of people who are, there are certain concentrations of type within field and or careers, and that's common because they're drawn to it. And I can tell you that from an organization where we are all about tradition and public service and duty, we have a lot of types that are sort of geared towards that within our organization. But we have some rogues in there. And so it's important to bring those perspectives out and to help enrich our conversations and our decision-making by making sure they have good, strong voices. So that's what we have.
Thank you. Any questions for Gretchen or Jason? Thank you both very much.
Greetings.
Welcome.
Hey, you're all engaged, too. That's my name's Sean. I'm with the Water Department. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about how leadership's working, and we're starting to see some progression with the leadership program. About a year and a half ago, we were sit down with the supervisors in the department, and we got talking about our five-year game plan, what things we need to make things work. And one of the issues that came up is the price of concrete. Triple C Concrete used to rent carts to us, and they decided through insurance reasons and stuff they would no longer do that. So what they did is they started charging an additional $100 per, if it's less than 5 yards of concrete, to the bill. So you're paying, concrete's about $128 a yard right now, so it'd be $228 a yard. Well, we could see that was kind of an issue, so we thought we'd start with a project. So this is the kind of cart that we thought we needed to use. We sat down, drew some pictures of it, and one of the guys on the crew, a new employee, is a really good welder. So we kind of pulled him aside and said, hey, do you think you can build this cart and work with us to do this? And he said, sure, I'll take the lead on it. I got it. And so we pulled it together, and he welded it all up, and we ran plasma cutters and welders and everything. And Paul Benavides painted the cart with epoxy paint, and it works. This cart cost us about $2,300 to build, four guys about 40 hours. This is going to save the city quite a bit of money. If you figure in the past year we've done around 150 loads of concrete with this little cart, saving $100 each, that's about $15,000. In 10 years' time, it'll be $150,000. The residual will last a long time. The next thing that we're working on is the wastewater department. They've got their Mr. Manhole project where they go out and rehabilitate manholes. They've been doing quite a few around town. They have one manhole that was getting in bad shape at the corner of Blue Lakes and Addison, the Five Points. You cannot shut that road down. It has to be fixed. So they were kind of going back and forth of what they should do. One of the guys on the crew, Chris Milam, he came up. He's worked with the Rapid Set product. They came in at 2 o'clock one morning, and they Mr. Manholed the road, and he went with these Rapid Set project, and they mixed all the concrete. They did two sewer manholes and two gate valves. By 7:30 that morning, the concrete was set up at 3,000 PSI. Roadwork had pulled the traffic signage, and they turned traffic back to it. Yeah. This is huge because now we can start doing some projects in major intersections and get the traffic back going on. Chris is in the water department. We cross-train back and forth with wastewater. Wastewater has a big factor. They took this over from the sewer department. We do a lot of work with the sewer department. We've cross-trained with the big factor. Yeah, you're a little bit behind. There's the finished product with the manhole. There we go.
Okay. I was wondering.
Used to that factor was used for cleaning out storm drains and catch basins and things like that. But this factor is unique because it's got a hydro excavation wand on it. So we've used this thing to start. We've used it to expose our utilities, our gas lines, phone lines, water lines, and it saves endless hours of shoveling and fatigue. When we have a leak, like on this one on Blue Lakes, we're able to bring this truck in and vac out the leak. It's a safer way of doing things. By them cross-training with us and teaching us how to use this, it's become another tool of the trade where we can save time and money and get on with our day instead of spending day after day after day working on projects like this. These are a few of the things that we've started doing. We've been with these training exercises. We've worked with several different departments, sitting with different people, and you learn from different people. On Eastland a couple weeks ago, they're doing a lot of work on Eastland Drive South. The traffic got pretty bad out there, and the street department had lowered the speed limit to 25 through there, but the traffic hasn't slowed down. So a call was made to the police department, and 13 citations were made in the next hour. It slowed traffic down and made it a lot better. this is a lot of the things that we're doing. We have these breakfasts and the retreats, and people from different areas are sitting down with each other, and we're talking back and forth and getting to know each other. And we're not talking about hunting or fishing or anything like that. It's business now, and that's where we're the direction that we want to go. This thing it's a slow process. It's kind of like wheels in motion, but we're starting to see it roll. And as people learn and get on board with it, more savings and cost-effective ways of doing things are going to work out a lot better. Are there any questions?
Very impressed.
Yeah.
That bin that you had welded in, if I understand, you go to the site and pick up the concrete instead of having them deliver, and that saves $100.
Correct.
Huh.
Correct.
Very good.
Okay.
Thanks. Thank you, Sean.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Well, you've heard a lot already about the benefits of quote unquote one city. I want to talk a little bit about my personal experience with this and my personal journey. As I think everybody here is aware, a little over a year ago, I made a decision to apply to the city of Twin Falls. And one of the reasons I applied to become the chief of police for the city of Twin Falls was because I knew that we were doing something right here. I knew that the city as an organization had some philosophies that I agreed with. I didn't really know what they were. I had heard the term one city. A few of you were on the Skype interview that I did, and we talked about that, and it fit with the philosophy of mine. Last May, we had our very first city retreat, where all city employees went out to Canyon Crest, and we had a one city retreat. And to me, that was very eye-opening. First of all, as still a relatively new employee of the city, I sat at a table with members from other departments in the city. And I started to understand that, you know, in government work, sometimes in departments we work in silos, right? The police department's concerned about what the police department does. The fire department's concerned about what the fire department does. The street, you know, and so on and so forth. I knew that wasn't really the case when I got here, but I couldn't quite put my finger on it. At that retreat, I sat down with, you know, a gentleman from the water department, from the fire department, even an officer from the police department that I hadn't had a lot of time yet to connect with. So I started getting some of those connections. Just here a few weeks ago, I had an opportunity to attend the Senior Executive Institute at the University of Virginia. I was told early this year that I would be attending this, so I was expecting to spend 2 weeks in Charlottesville, Virginia. But I didn't really know what to expect. Before I went, I was told by Mr. Rothweiler to enjoy the journey. And, you know, what does that mean? Okay, good flight, you know, enjoy the journey. Okay. I didn't really know. And they were, you know, it was a little bit vague. I had spoken a little bit with Captain Hicks, who had attended the year before, and got some feedback from him and from Brian Pike. So I thought I had a good idea. I was traveling with Mandy Thompson, who's going to speak in a little bit. And I knew Mandy a little bit, but I didn't know her that well. But what I'll tell you, in that 2 weeks, and having been in the police service for over 26 years, that was probably the best and most eye-opening training that I had ever received, because it went beyond the law and went beyond tactics and went beyond how to be a better police chief or a better police officer. But it really went into how to be a good person, how to be a good leader, how to help lead into a high-performance organization. And I thought I was a pretty good chief of police, and I think I could come here and run the day-to-day operations for this city. But one of the phrases that struck me back there was that you want to leave a legacy. You don't want to become a legend. And so then I started thinking, well, what's my legacy going to be here at the city of Twin Falls, and how do I accomplish that? You know, we had a gentleman come in, interesting for me. We spent a lot of time talking about poetry and how that can work over into personal growth. And one of the phrases that we were challenged with is, what is your verse? What will your verse be? And again, that got me thinking, what can I do in my position, the position that the citizens of Twin Falls have put me into, to make not just the police department, but the city organization as a whole, and hence our community, a better place? And how do I accomplish that? We talked about connection before content. And I think personal connections are really where we set up how we go about providing the service. You know, people serving people. That slogan that we see under our city seal, that we see here in this building, and all about, well, what does that really mean? Well, that's having those connections. And you've heard a couple stories about those very connections and how we provide excellent level service as a government entity. So my job now, after going through that training, is to continue and always try to strive to refine my verse and to build my legacy. You've heard me talk about the one team, one mission, one city. And I think that slogan really fits well with what we're trying to accomplish here in the city of Twin Falls. And attending this training at SEI, I think, was a great thing for me personally and professionally, and I truly hope that our citizens benefit just a little bit from me going to that training and helping to provide better service in all aspects of our city government. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Good evening. I struggled to decide what I wanted to say tonight. When we got to SEI, Craig and I, it took a long time to get there. We got there an entire day early because there's no quick way to get from Twin Falls to Charlottesville, Virginia. So we did. We had an opportunity to get to know one another, and I will forever be grateful for that. But when we walked into this classroom where we would spend the next 2 weeks, we were given a book, this journal, and kind of to do with as we will. But I'm a note taker. Something I learned through this process is I do better. I concentrate more when I take notes. I took copious amounts of notes. And so as I started going through this journal on Friday and then a little bit more today, I had so much I wanted to share and realized that there's just really no way to impart everything in 5 minutes that, you know, we had 2 weeks to learn. But Craig did a really great job of describing the personal and professional journey that we went on. Mine was very similar in a lot of ways, but it was also different, and I think that's what's really impactful about the time that we spent there and this opportunity that employees have been given to get this training is that everybody comes away with something a little bit different. Our takeaways are a little bit different. We take away different nuggets of information that we find to be very relevant to us and our maybe where we are in our lives or where we are in our professional positions. And so, you know, I wanted to share a little bit about what I took away from it and really how I do think that this will truly impact not only us as employees, but how we deliver the services that we do to our citizens. The first is about empowerment. One City truly is about empowerment, and you heard that from Sean, and you heard that from Aaron, and everyone who's gotten up here and spoken, because it gives us an opportunity to go beyond our job descriptions and go beyond what maybe we perhaps were hired to do, because we all have a lot more talents and a lot more things to offer the organization perhaps than just fighting fires or being a supervisor in the water department. And so it gives us the opportunity to share those things. And when you can make connections with other people within the city, and you start to understand the attributes and the talents and the strengths that we have, then you can start crossing paths and delivering those services even more effective. Because when somebody that has this skill with this rapid set concrete, you know, a few years ago, he may have had that skill, but he wasn't going to tell anybody about that. But we've opened up these lines of communication, and where he's saying, hey, I have something to offer the city. I can save the city money, and we can do a better job of delivering the services that we need to deliver. And when you give people the opportunity to speak up at all levels of the organization, it really empowers people. I know that the budget that you all discuss every week has a very significant piece on employee retention. And retention is key to moving this forward because, of course, as we train people, we want them to stay. And what we pay them and how much we pay them is a piece of it. It truly is. We learned a lot about that, about kind of what we call our basic hygiene needs. And being paid enough for what we do truly is important. But what is even more important is when you engage your employees. And there's a quote that we heard shared by a former executive from GE who was told the day of a employee's retirement that all of these years you paid me for my hands when you could have had my brains for free. And it just goes to show that we may have hired this person to do something that he was skillful in with his hands, but we have to tap all those other abilities that they have. And it's also about recognizing the goals and ambitions that people have and giving them the ability to move forward. I have been given the opportunity through SEI to do something at the city, and I truly hope that I'm able to accomplish that and I'm able to make a lasting impact on the city because of the training that I was given. Something else that we talked a lot about at SEI was the essence of public service, and it really helped, I think, Craig and I both kind of reconnect with why we are in public service and why we do what we do. And at the end of the day, it's because we chose to serve our community. One of our speakers talked about all the various levels of government, from federal to state and everything in between. And what was said that really hit me was that there is no other form of government that has as much impact on the daily lives of its citizens as local government. You talk about federal government and all the laws that are passed down or even at the state, but truly, really, the citizens are not able to have daily interactions with people at the state and federal level. They have interactions with us at the local level every single day. That was very impactful to me. Travis asked me to share a little story. One of the days, it was in the second week, we had a case study about Prince William County, Virginia. There was a lot of people from Virginia, proximity obviously playing a role in that. But the former city manager, or excuse me, the former county manager of Prince William County is a gentleman by the name of Craig Gerhart. Craig is now actually a part of the SEI team. But Craig actually took the high performance model and put it into action in Prince William County. So on this day, we had this case study on what really high performance organization looks like in a local government setting. And they started talking about things like value and vision and leadership philosophy and how you get to those things. And Travis had told me I would have an aha moment or an aha day, and we weren't supposed to use our phones, but I sent him a text and I said, I think I just had my aha moment. Because what they were telling us is high performance, or what we were all there striving to do, we're doing here in Twin Falls. And it was so exciting because I didn't realize how far we would come. But the other side of that is that there were people that we were there in class with that came from organizations of thousands of people. And they may have been one of four or five people who had ever been exposed to this concept. So here they were, one of five, that were trying to make change in an organization of 4,000. And Craig and I were sitting in a very different position where we were two of 200 and, I don't know, 80 people. I'm not sure what our employee count is. But where nearly a third of our employees have been exposed to this. And it made me so excited to think of all the possibilities and how much easier of a time that we had going home and taking this back with us, because we've had the support of the city council and the support of you all financially investing in not only the employees and this training, but truly in the organization. And I wanted to leave with the interesting kind of other side of the coin of Prince William County, we had a gentleman in our class who was a battalion chief for the county. And after we had heard this case study and we saw all, you know, how it was implemented and how fabulous it was, later that evening he shared with us that that went away. That when Craig left, the woman that was hired to replace him did not support the concept and support the organizational change that they had worked so hard for. And I know, you know, many of you have heard Travis say that someday he won't be here, that this cannot be about Travis Rothweiler. It cannot be about anybody at any level in the organization. It has to be about organizational change and about truly creating a workplace where we want to be engaged and empowered so that if our leaders leave, we're still here fighting for this this organization that we have all collectively built. So I think it is vital that we continue to invest in One City and invest in not only bringing someone from the University of Virginia here to do the training to a larger number of employees, but continuing to send people back to LEAD and to SCI, because I truly think that you will not see any limits to the benefits of making those investments in our employees. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mandy. Have a big wrap-up, Mitch? Well, I want to say that just being able to hear from the employees throughout the organization, I think, is a much greater testament to the value of, I don't even want to call it a program because it's not, to the value of this philosophy that we've adopted as an organization. I think just the handful of projects you've been able to point out that have been impacted by improve communication and an openness. I think Mandy's comment of empowerment really is kind of what I see the one of the greatest values of this. It gives people the opportunity to share their talents and skills to serve the citizens better. So I really appreciate the input that you've been able to get us tonight. Chris Dockington.
Well, in my private background in quasi-private, I've probably been through 6 or 7 different management models. Certainly, communication is the goal of all of them, increased connectivity to your customers. The One City has some unique and I think bound to be effective methodology. I still think it comes down to the quality of people we hire that are not silo people. I'm not trying to co-op your language, but people that have some relevant life experiences can communicate outside their comfort zone. And if I understand, that's one of the benefits forcing or allowing you to think outside your comfort zone. I think I was one of the people that raised the question originally, how do we know if the One City concept works? It would appear to me that it has to be internal to each one of you. The communication skills that you're learning are a long-term commitment that'll help you forever in your life, not only the city here, but raising your kids and dealing with bill collectors and even politicians. So thank you for sharing your experiences. I'm impressed with what I've seen, but it still comes down to one word, communication or communicability.
All right. Well, thank you all. Be good to keep moving here. To the budget? Okay. Next. All good down there? All right. So next on the agenda, we have a presentation of the city manager's recommended budget for fiscal year 2017, followed by citizen input. Mr. Rothweiler, would you like us to recite the slides back to you?
That was good. You'll notice there are fewer this evening.
So actually tonight we're going to go pretty fast through this. You'll notice that there are much fewer slides because I think that there are some pretty dynamic conversations that the council really needs to have as we kind of move forward. And tonight the goal is to hopefully be in a position where next week when we hold a public hearing and we ask you to adopt the budget, that as citizens may choose to approach, they understand the total ramifications of the decision that is going to be before you next week. So we would like to be able to set that final budget, if you will. Obviously, you reserve the right to change that right up until the final vote, but we want to put out the clearest budget that and message to our community that we possibly can tonight. So again, everything that we do is based upon the strategic plan, and I think that, you know, as we talked about, everything really does connect to that internal organization, and what a great job from that team. Mm-hmm. You know, that is a representative sample of the men and women who have chosen to dedicate themselves to our organization. And I think that when we start talking about how Focus Area 8, the internal organization, really is that connecting glue of all of the other focus areas, I think tonight illustrates that. I think that the men and women and the things that they're doing really show the value and the importance of us attracting interesting, talented, curious folks into our organization and retaining the incredible talent that we have. So we've gone through this several times. We've talked about what the potential monthly and annual impacts are, and again, it is really dependent upon where your house falls, if you're looking at property taxes, because again, the tax rate is a simple multiplier. And then really, when we take a look at the utility bills, if you fall into those average categories on the utility bills, we believe that your monthly cost should be about $1.81 more per month under this budget than they were in the past. We spent time explaining the impacts of each one of those. We also spent time talking about how did we fall into this position of having nearly $300,000 of monies that remained unappropriated as a part of this budget. And when we set that budget moving forward, we shared with you that we reserved approximately $60,000 of the budget because we were concerned about what could happen to that new construction value should it not reach $40 million. And when it came in nearly 72% higher and created $213,420 that wasn't appropriated, it gave us some opportunities. It kind of sets the stage for this evening in terms of how much, if any, of that money do you want to include in this budget. And that decision is going to really drive one of these two possible tax rates that are kind of bookend. If you take all of the $300,000 that has been allocated, you will be taking what's statutorily allowed for you. You'll leave the entire foregone balance intact. If you choose to take less, you will add to the city's foregone balance. In fact, if you choose to take absolutely none of it, your tax rate will be $8.03 per $1,000 of taxable value, and the foregone balance will grow by that $300,000 because what you do not take that is statutorily allowed will fall into that foregone balance, and right now it is $2,100,000 and nearly $2.15 million. So she's always going to watch me for numbers, right? So when you take a look, and then what is the impact of that decision? We kind of wanted to lay that out, that for every $100,000 of that $300,000 that you elect not to take, this is that general ramification to the potential tax rate. And again, remember, the tax rate is a simple multiplier because if you're going to look at that average house inside of the city of Twin Falls where the homeowner's exemption has gone up, well, this house won't necessarily benefit from that because they get to take 50% of that total taxable value up to a maximum ceiling. Since this house, its 50% doesn't quite reach the maximum ceiling, they won't see any benefit from that increased homeowner's exemption. And you could see the impacts of this budget on that particular residence over the different options that you have before you. A different story is what happens to that house that can take advantage of that full homeowner's exemption again, which is not something that we set. It is set this year and last year through indexing. Next year, it will be a flat $100,000 as set by the Idaho legislature. And you can illustrate what occurs there. And you can see in this case, even with those slight adjustments in the tax rate, this house at $200,000 of value that is owner-occupied pays less in property taxes under every single scenario, whether you elect to take $300,000 and incorporate it or you elect to take zero. So last week we presented this list. You'll notice that this list is less one item, and that is the city's website. As a result of our team having some conversations, they believe that they might be able to do some work this year. And so we're going to continue to work with our provider. We've removed that from the list. If we are not able to be successful with our provider in where we hope that we can, the long-term planning committee may bring that back before you, which again is the beginning of our budget process. And we'll start that in 3 short months from now. Lori is happiest time of the year really is about 12 months of the year, so she's always happy. And so what you see here are the items in gold. The items in gold were the items that I removed that were included by the long or included for funding and suggested for funding by the city's long-term planning committee. The things in white are things that have kind of came up as reductions or potential issues and concerns as we've gone through this year's budgeting process. Again, when you start at the first of the year, there are things that kind of evolve and change, and so that's why some of those different things are there. We have representatives of the city's executive leadership team here that can help answer any one of these questions, and know that this isn't an all-inclusive list. There may be things that you have heard, things that you have thought that we should include that we didn't, that certainly should be discussed, vetted fully as we continue to move forward. The goal tonight is to make sure that when we bring forward that ordinance for your adoption next week, that it includes all of the things that you want to fund for fiscal year 2017 that begins on October 1st.
Don Hall.
Travis, just for my own edification, can you tell me, I know that we have up there the mid-year, potential mid-year compensation through BDPA.
Yep.
Why are we getting that information mid-year? Why are we not, is there a timing issue with getting the information? Because I'll be honest with you, I struggle with putting money aside because we might need to do something else when I just think it's better planning to know that up front.
And I think that's a really good point. So right now we are in the process of going through all of the positions inside of the organization and seeing exactly where they align in comparison not only to position on grade, but also positions within our organization and are they appropriately placed on our salary table. That process is ongoing, and it's not going to be completed by next week. We have no idea what that is going to share with us, what that's going to show. We don't know if positions are appropriately aligned. We do believe that there are some areas that are going to need some adjustments. We just can't tell you where those are right now. And so by taking $150,000 of this year's budget, it allows us to correct those deficiencies right now. One of the things that this council did that was very helpful in the area of retention is you did a mid-year adjustment, which is not something that we typically do by moving the table 4%. And we also shared with you at that time that we were going to start this BDPA review of all of the positions. That is ongoing, and that's not complete. And so as a result of that, the question is when you get the report and you get the study, what is the timeline for implementation? If we have some level of funding in this year's budget, we can take a look at maybe moving some or all up to some certain allocation and threshold over the course of the mid-year. without, we would have to find other opportunities that would result in long-term salary savings. So, for example, to move the table 4%, it was roughly $150,000 this year, and we were able to take savings from our health insurance premiums that weren't realized in this current year in comparison to what we budgeted by comparison to the expenditure. So that's why this is on here. I think the other thing that we've talked about in the past is being in a position that we can respond to the uncertainty of what our competition is doing. And really, we can have that conversation. But everybody inside of the state of Idaho who looks for local government who is competing with us is setting their budgets right now. And what their ultimate salary table moves are, what their compensation adjustments are going to be, really isn't known until we after all get completed with the budget and the dust settles.
Will that be part of their study, what everybody else is going to come to, or is this just more of a internal where we are?
This is just the internal of where we're at right now.
When do we get to the point where we're caught up, where we'll have this information prior to the budgeting? Is that possible? Are we always going to be behind in this process?
This is actually the first time that we have looked at all of the positions within the city since that initial move to our BDPA system. And so we've looked at pockets of work groups and had them evaluated. So this is the first time that we're looking across the board at all positions.
Do you think we should do that more often in the future? What are your thoughts here? It's hard for me to think we're always trying to catch up in mid-year.
A lot of times when we look at pockets of the positions, we have very little movement. Some of the positions have had some pretty significant changes in their job duties. And so rather than take a specific group and try and compare them, this time we decided to look at all of them. We got a little behind schedule with our workload and with BDPA's workload and the contracts that they have out. One of the things that we use from a salary survey is we belong to what's called Northwest Data. And so the salary information from most of our competitors are included in that report that's generated
November.
It's usually about November. After the budgets have been set, we've moved into the new fiscal year. So trying to kind of get those two processes, the internal alignment and the salary placement, to work together. I think we're getting closer.
Again, do you think we're going to be doing a full push for all of them more often in the future, or are we going to do pockets?
You know, I think.
And what are you? What's your opinion, Susan? What should we do?
I think most of them are pretty well aligned, truthfully, because we've done grades 3 through 9, we've done 10 through 18, we've looked at 10, we've looked at clerical positions, and we don't typically have a lot of movement. But I think we've got a couple areas where we may see some change. And do I think that it needs to be done more often?
In totality, like we're doing this year?
In totality, probably not.
Okay.
I mean, I think we have a pretty good feel of when it needs to be done and it needed to be done.
Thank you.
Okay. Chris Talkington.
Oh, I think.
Oh, did you have something to add to that, Travis? Sorry.
Nope.
Go ahead.
Nope. I'm just standing, and if I'm the one to answer the question, I will. If not, I'm going to turn the mic over to...
Well, this is either my 25th or 26th budget, and I'm impressed every year with the increasing efficiency and the absolute bias towards citizen input all along the process of reaching a city budget. I keep thinking every year, how do we do better except bribe people to come down to City Hall and speak, and I don't think we're quite there yet. If anybody doubts the effectiveness and the truthfulness and openness of city government or any level of government, they need to come to us during this tax time. I'm most appreciative how the council heretofore has not resulted to the temptation of dipping into the foregone $2.4 million. I think it shows the discipline the council historically has shown. Certainly, it is much better to be in a growing economy where the tax base is expanding. It gives us more positive options. But the tendency periodically comes up to why don't we spend everything we get? And this council and other councils I worked with have shown good restraint on behalf of the taxpayers. I would, for Nikki and Ruth, especially since it's just your first budget, you're probably wondering on the $300,000 how are we ever going to decide how to spend that, if at all. And I would hope that the council will take the funding options as provided by the city manager on a piece-by-piece or a motion-by-motion basis so that if you do not agree with how some of that money were to be spent, you have to vote against the budget. I think that should be a separate consideration. If you win it, fine, and if you don't, you can still vote for the budget separately for passage. But this has been another spectacular year, and I, you know, I'd be happy to credit the One City concept for helping it make a more effective, seamless institution that we're representing to our taxpayers.
Suzanne Hawkins.
Thank you. So last week I asked for a breakdown on the restrooms and band shell improvements. And just because I'm at City Park a lot, the restroom portion of that was $190,000, we were told, if we take out the band shell and the extra miscellaneous fees. Is that a complete rebuild of the restroom, or is it fixing things? Or what is that $190,000 by?
It's a complete rebuild of the existing restrooms.
Boy, oh boy. Thank you.
Don Hall?
Well, I'll wait until Travis does the breakdown. I think he must do that.
The band shell is 50. So then resurfacing the band shell is $50,000.
Thank you.
So Travis, question on this is additional funding options, potential funding options. You're asking for our input on these items because obviously that adds up to a little more than $300,000.
Yeah, you can't afford all of them. This is in a sense a really good exercise because we talk about the value of what the long-term planning committee does. You have $300,000 should you choose to spend it. And obviously that list is significantly more than $300,000. And so it's kind of aligning the parts and the pieces so that you don't exceed $300,000. In fact, we can't even tell you that it's exactly $300,000. It's slightly less. In fact, I'll ask Lori. I think it's, do you have $273,000? Do you have $288,000 as opposed to $300,000? And so you have $288,000 if you choose to fund any of those items there.
That's if we take the full 3%, though.
It's if you take the full 3%. If you elect not to take the statutory allowed 3%, then, again, some portion of that would revert back to the foregone balance.
Again, we're going to wrestle over some of these things, but I'll just give you my input. I am absolutely 100% behind getting a victim witness coordinator back on city staff that we lost years ago. I think that if we had that position, some of the challenges that we are going through right now would be less. And more importantly, we would serve our community better. I don't know who's more important in our community than folks that have gone through victimization. They need support. And a good victim witness coordinator can do
incredible things for those folks. And so I'm not going to relent on that. That's something that I think is absolutely paramount. Number two, and I know that it's not on there because we probably haven't talked about it a lot, I don't know if maybe we need to have a discussion about replenishing the art fund, the public art fund. Is it on there? Did I miss it?
It is not.
Okay. And I think that was in the neighborhood of $20,000, some portion of that. I like the idea of replenishing it because we didn't want to wipe it out as much as we did, but we also wanted to do a quality project, and that's what we're doing. But if we have some options to replenish that, that's important to me. The rest of it, I don't know where to go because there's so many needs.
Susanna Hawkins.
Thanks. So to come up with that odd amount of 288 or wherever it ends up, nothing's going to really add up that way here. So
that's right.
Make suggestions of where we'd like to see you put it in the budget, and then what we take, like a portion less than the 3% if we don't hit the 288, or how does that work? What happens with that little bit of money at the end?
So you have several options. One of the options that you could take a look. So if you look, some of these items are very one-time expenditures. And as one-time expenditures, one of the strategies that we've used because we have a strong financial position is to fund some of those with one-time monies in the form of cash reserves. There are some items up here that could be going ongoing operational costs, and you would not want to fund those items with any portion of cash reserves because that doesn't make good financial sense. So it's a cost that's going to be ongoing, and you want to be able to make sure that you can cover those costs moving forward. So if you picked a couple of items that were operational in nature and one capital item or two capital items that were incredibly important, we have the strategies and the opportunities to use different reserves that we have accumulated over years to be able to help augment some of those one-time projects. I don't believe it would be prudent to buy the whole list.
Right.
In fact, I think that there's a lot of leaving on the table to be wrestled with in subsequent fiscal years.
Okay. Thank you. While I have my mic on real quick, my top two preferences, just personally, would be the number one would be the victim witness coordinator, definitely. And I would really love to see a new bathroom at City Park. So those would be my two top choices off the list.
Nikki Boyd.
Well, I am have become very fond of the victim witness coordinator position because I made some phone calls and found out more about how it works. We have a lot of great agencies in town, and it seemed like lots of them show up to things, but everybody is very focused on the portion that they do. And so I came to understand that the actual victim themselves can get kind of shuffled in between or not really know what they're doing, but this coordinator would be the one that could connect all the dots for them and keep them. You know, I was thinking, well, once you get an attorney, your attorney's going to help you. Well, no, they're just doing the case. They're not helping this need, this very specific need. And so I'm very fond of that. And then I have a question about restore training travel in various budgets. Is that an ongoing to more of our one city concept?
That is ongoing, yes, potentially, because you want to always be developing the aptitudes of our employees, and we try to keep those to be fairly consistent. And as you're looking at different training opportunities, you know, a lot of our departments will create training schedules for people over the years to be able to move forward. This was additional funding, not necessarily associated with one city,
okay. But
these were additional aptitude and technical training specifically for their roles across many, 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 many different departments that I removed here and there at the work with the department leaders to help balance the budget.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else, Nikki?
No.
Greg Land.
Travis, before I make my comments, could you explain to us again the difference between the yellow and the white?
The yellow are the items that were suggested to me from the long-term planning committee for funding. The white were items that occurred after the conversation with the long-term planning committee, so when their work had completed, and the time in which we submitted a balanced budget to you, as well as other things that have kind of emerged since we published that budget based upon current events.
Okay, thank you, Travis. I thought that was the case, but I was getting a little confused on the training because it sounded like you cut it. So when did you cut it? Before it got to long range or after?
So the long-term planning committee doesn't really dive into the amount of training that's going to go forward. Okay. This is really submitted by each of the department leaders, and it's submitted at the time, and then we go through a larger budgetary review conversation.
Okay. Thank you, Travis. Mm-hmm. Well, first I'm going to be in favor of taking the full 3%. I believe this list, and I'm sure there are 10 other things that Travis could have put on here, just knew that they were just too far down the list to really even look at. And I agree with Chris. We've been frugal. We haven't always taken the 3%. In fact, on my 10 years on council, I think we took some foregone 1 year, but specifically for streets, and most of the rest of the time we've taken... Some of the time taking the 3, some of the time not, but mostly not taking the 3%.
Nine out of the last 12 years, this council has elected not to take the statutory allowed amounts.
Right.
And that is what has caused the foregone balance to be built to the place that it is right now.
But I would also counter that I think that the foregone balance is built. has been built up, and I think that's great, and we're saving the tax money, but I think that's why we end up lists like this. I really thought the restrooms at the park were in the budget 2 years ago, and I kept waiting, well, I wonder when they're going to build them. And so, you know, that's kind of where I even told somebody down there at Shane's Beer Fest, I'm thinking, well, I wonder when they're going to build those restrooms. You know, what is Shane?
It's not Shane.
It was his idea, and he's in charge of it, so it's Shane's benefit. Okay. Okay, but anyway, I will come down, get back to seriousness. I will agree. I was not going to tell anyone I'd met with the family because that was my private business, but a couple of different new organizations decided that they were going to let the world know that I had met with them, so it's out now already. And that was one of the things that they really commented on, was that they were working through the county witness coordinator, but they still just didn't understand the process fully. And without Glenn Etta, I can't remember her last name, nor can I pronounce her last name, that was here last week, she has been acting as a personal representative for them on a volunteer basis. And it's obvious to me that that position, we need to fill it, and we need to get it staffed, and we need to get it effective or get it working and being effective. I'm with Suzanne. When it comes down to it, you'd rather use the porta potty that the people have brought in rather than the city restroom. It's time for us to make an improvement in that facility. Okay, and that's where we are right now. I would rather use the porta potty than the restrooms at the city park. And I'm looking at Wendy, and it's not your fault, Wendy. I'm just getting, it's your parks, though, so I'm looking there. And so that's those are the two things that I'm a firm believer in. And I believe that somewhere else on that list we can get started on with the other, I believe it's going to be 34,000 left, if my math is right. After those two things, somewhere along that list, we can certainly maybe have seed money for the electronics or a portion of it for the art, like Don mentioned. I'm willing to go with any of those. I know that I was deeply involved with Baxter's Park, and it pains me to think we've never been able to do that on Blake, but it's far down the list for me, even though that was my one goal, not one goal, but one of my major goals as mayor. So That's on the down the list for me. The band shell improvements, I think we need to work with somebody on that one. A service or education or somebody might be able to help us get that particular done. So I'm going to go with the witness coordinator and the restrooms at the park, city park, and then $34,000. I'll probably go with, I would probably split it half with the refurbish the refund the art, and then some seed money for the reader board, because I got a feeling we're going to be doing that out of reserves, a portion of it, with a help from our community, and this could be some seed money for that. And if anybody has a different opinion, I can see why you would, because I rambled really badly. So.
Mm-hmm. Ruth Pierce.
So I just want to be perfectly clear on the restroom, because I've heard a bunch of numbers thrown around. Restrooms are 190, band shells 50.
58.
I'm trying to get up to 264.
Oh.
Go ahead. It's right here.
Yeah, the bathroom was 58
mm-hmm.
and 16 for other projects.
Right. Yep. So Lori showed me an email or something that, so in that number it includes the refinishing the floors at the Presbyterian Church where we play the adult volleyball programs and purchasing new standards and the judging station for that. So that's the additional $16,000 that is making that number not add up if you add those other two.
So we've got 190, 58, mm-hmm. and 16.
Yes.
Well, and maybe it's 50, but all the numbers I have is 50 for the band shell.
50. Okay.
And then 16 for those other two.
So I'm still not coming up with 264, and that's...
Well, and I think you're right. I think it's still a little off.
Yeah, we don't have to finalize it today, but just to make sure we're perfectly clear on the 264, because I think we've got some dollars kind of rambling around that we're all trying to make sure that we get.
And I double-checked some of the numbers before I came tonight, and so I have 50 for the band shell. I have 190 for the bathroom, and then the volleyball stands were 5, and the First Presbyterian floor would be 6. That's an additional 11. So
I get...
And I don't know...
251, no. Yeah, 251, so we're shy, 13,000.
And we cut a little bit out of the volleyball stands in the First Presbyterian floor from what the numbers, because they were working with 16,000, but I think it's really only 11. And I don't know... So maybe Shane can help me here.
So the 58 for the band shell, 190 for the bathrooms, and the 16 were those three projects you talked about, the resurfacing of the floor, volleyball stands, and replacements. But those were numbers from long-term planning. So if those had changed from when we got to the budget process, you'll have a little bit of a difference there. So that's where those original numbers had come from.
So I just quickly adjusted the PowerPoint presentation so you see that the two items that were there. And when you look at the resurfacing of the band or the gymnasium floor, I don't know if that's the highest priority that we have, just personally in comparison to other public opportunities moving forward.
So I have a few comments. So I would agree that the victim witness coordinator position is important. I have a question about the reserve pool operations, because that's a significant number of an ongoing expense that we haven't discussed much, and I appreciate that we don't have an answer, but I also don't want to get 3 months into the new fiscal year and suddenly have a pool to operate at $300,000 a year.
Do you want me to talk about that?
If you might.
Okay.
Please.
So let me go through my stack of notes real quick. So I think that there's a couple of different ways to look at the $180,000. One is based upon our best experience. And our best experience illustrates the time in which we operated the pool. And what I have here back in 2000 to 2001,
We had total pool expenditures back then totaling $346,000. We had total revenues coming into the system offsetting that by $132,000, leaving a net deficit of pool operations of $214,000. Obviously, that was in 2000 and 2001. Now, when you take a look at the current way in which the Y has been sharing the information with us in the past, I believe, if I'm going to recall their numbers, their worst financial year was slightly greater than a $6,000 per year loss, and that was their best year, and their worst year was about a $17,000-ish loss. They offer different programs than maybe what we did, but the other side is they credit the membership that they receive from the other facilities to offset some portion of the pool operations. This is really a number that we've used as a best stab moving forward. So what does that mean? So we're still doing our due diligence, and we're still looking, we're still investigating. We've requested additional information from the YMCA. We're waiting for that information to come in, but we're in continual dialogue so that we do receive that information, and we'll be in a position to review that and then begin that process of sharing staff's recommendations to the council moving forward. That, unfortunately, will not be concluded by the time you have to adopt the budget. So if the council were to, at some point in time, make the decision that operating a pool was in the community's best interest, we believe that you need to reserve about $180,000 to be able to do that. That is in addition to the $120,000 that we set aside right now and we provide as a management fee for operating the pool. And that's really what we're looking at as a conservative approach, because we don't know what it's going to take to operate the pool. You know, when you start looking at hiring individuals who are now going to be qualifying for public benefits, while we've had a really good understanding of what those potential costs are going to be, and I know that Wendy and other members of the team have focused hard on that, understanding the revenue component is tough. So if mid-year we felt as an organization that it was in the best interest to operate the pool, we believe that we should be prepared to set aside about $180,000. And if you were to use cash reserves for a single year, know that that eats into the amount of new money that we would have available in subsequent years to operate as an organization. So $180,000 roughly equals 1% of the 3% that we bring in. And if you take and operate the pool and you commit $180,000 of cash reserves this year, you are already taking 1% next year just to support FY2000 operations in FY2018. Because that is an ongoing life expense, and we cannot use cash reserves to be able to offset that. So it becomes one of those, is it going to happen? Maybe. Do you reserve the money and it doesn't? What happens? Well, you've collected it, and it would be available to the council for an additional purpose or other purpose. So our policy is, at any point in time, should we deviate from the original plan as a set by the city council, staff has the obligation to come to council because you grant the spending authority. And so we would come and ask you how to reappropriate that $180,000 should the city not take over the operations of the pool, and you were to fund it now.
So I think it's important that we reserve those funds because we don't know what the answer is going to be. Knowing that once we know the answer, if it's we don't need it, then we can look at other opportunities. Personally, and I totally agree that the restrooms need rehabbed at the city park, I would be more supportive of using reserve funds for that because it's a one-time expense rather than trying to plug that into the operations. So if you were to look at the victim witness coordinator, reserving pool operations funds, which we know likely won't be the full 180,000 because, I mean, unless it were to happen immediately, because it's October starts in October, right away. And leaving the balance, which is about $44,000, to possible compensation adjustments. That's how, as I looked at these priorities, that's how I kind of read this. Of those were operational things that needed to be in the budget. Most of these others are really things that could be funded by reserves if they were critical.
So I was wrong, and I apologize.
Okay.
So you've already set a maximum spending threshold, so you can't use reserves. So I apologize. I gave you an option that's not available, and it just kind of struck me. And my trusty CFO didn't catch me when I misspoke, and I had to catch myself, so it was a bit delayed.
Okay.
You have set the maximum last week. We published the public hearing based upon that. The use of cash reserves is included in the total amount that you would appropriate, and so I gave you a bad option. I apologize. That's not readily available to you. You could fund, if you wanted to fund the restrooms, you could take a look at the priorities that we've placed inside of the park budget, and you could swap out something that we as a staff felt was a priority for the restrooms, or we could come up with alternatives or something to that effect.
Well, I guess, I mean, I'm going to agree with it. I'll agree with the comment that Greg made. First of all, I think we need to take the full 3%. I think we have enough things that we need to be trying to figure out how to deal with. So, honestly, plug two or three projects in that get there, and I'll be supportive of that, knowing that some of them are a little up in the air. Greg Lanting.
Well, confusion.
Travis, I know out in the middle of the budget years, people have came to us with somewhat of an emergency situation, and we funded it using the cash reserves, and it wasn't part of the budget.
That's right. And you can do an amended budget, but right now we're asking you to do the main budget.
Okay, all right. So we just can't include it in this conversation, but we could fund one of these with
sometime after the fiscal year. Okay, if you have a different funding plan, we can have that conversation.
And I think that's what I had in my mind we were doing. I wasn't having the feel that we were going to do it right away. And I'm sorry, I actually had another point that I lost, because that one got me like, wait a minute, those cash reserves could never be used?
Right.
It's kind of like, I remember what it was. I guess I'm not as in favor of the 180, because I know we had, for the pool, to reserve that back, because I know we had other partners who came forth at that time and bid against the Y to help us run the pool, and I know some of that ownership has changed for that one entity, but they still may be there. And I still reserve the right as a council. I know where it started costing a bunch of money is when we covered the pool. And I've also been there in the wintertime and been in the pool on a Tuesday night, and there's six of us in there. And because we're doing a kayaking class and the rest of the place is a tomb. And so I really think that we at least need to look at that option, that to say if we end up taking this pool over, to give us a year to figure out what's going on, we don't run it in the winter. Because I think that would cut a lot of our costs. And maybe I'm Pollyanna on how much that might be. Yeah. But I also know that when the pool was uncovered, it was breaking. It was much closer to breaking even than it was after we covered it.
Yeah. So. I know that we have a lot of – so ever since we've engaged in this conversation, we've had a lot of community interest in terms of what our relationship would be, what our hours would look like, what are some of the different changes in services. And what I've shared with everybody is that those are all wonderful questions. We haven't gotten to the position to be able to answer any of them yet. And so looking at schedules, looking at current contracts, current arrangements, current commitments that the Y has currently made, we haven't started that process. We know that there are users throughout the entire year, whether they're high school swim teams that will roll into the winter. We know that there are recreational swim teams that use the facility, as well as you know, daytime users. And so one of the things that we want to do is, should we get into that place, we really want to be mindful of where that cost-benefit analysis is, but also the level of service that we're able to provide to our citizens. Chris Togginson.
Well, I'd hope that council would keep an open mind for the next week and think over what the city manager has talked to us about, because I really don't want to cast a firm vote for any or all of this money right now. I am least, however, I am least convinced of the victim witness coordinator for the simple reason that adding personnel is the last option in my mind. It's a reoccurring expense year after year. There are programs that duplicate parts of victim witness coordinators, CASA in particular. I think we should also look to see if there's a way that the city and county might be able to better coordinate. I don't see any data that supports the need for a victim witness, but having worked in Juvia for 13 years, I'm sure we could always use a person, but I would like to have a period of time to study the need on this. I think we're reacting to the news that we've all been subject to this last few months without even seeing the validity of need. I say that because I think the city manager would have put that in a must-fund category earlier on. This strikes me as needing more study. But the other operations that we're talking about and funding, I think most of them have some validity. Might help if in our minds we can scratch off two or three of these so we can narrow the options for next week.
So is that clear as mud to you, Travis? Would it be helpful for you to have a little more solid direction from opinions this evening?
If I were to speak in general terms, I'm gonna say that most prefer two of the options up there. The two options were the victim witness coordinator and the $190,000 improvement to the restrooms. That's what I heard from a majority of the council. Taking the full 3%, the balance of those funds, there were a couple of different options ranging from seed money for the reader board, using some for potential compensation adjustments. We talked a little bit about training. The art, and then using part of that or that half of that to take the $22,000 for the art that was used to offset for the because the total project I believe was right around 54.
It was 20,000 for the landscape component.
I suggested a cap at 20. So.
Well, is it going to expedite things if we get a do or die on these projects tonight?
No. So what we want to do is what we would ask is that next week there's going to be a conversation, and what we need to do is have the council approve a finalized ordinance. And so you will hold a public hearing, and then after the public hearing, we are going to ask you to adopt the ordinance. We may ask you to stand in recess for a few minutes just while we kind of tweak those numbers so that we can then bring to you a final ordinance to consider that evening and ultimately adopt.
So we'd have that conversation prior to the public hearing or after the public hearing of kind of finalizing the balance of these funds?
I think that you can do it either way. Okay. So we are positioning the agenda next week. Next week we have a conversation about taking a look at the work that Jackie and her team has spent over the course of the last almost 2 years, I believe, in doing the specs and incorporating the standards for public works instruction specs with the local modifications.
her and her team have spent quite a bit of time going through those with the development and building community. We want to share what that is and the potential ramifications of what that means moving forward. Depending upon the amount of time that we have available, we'll do a recap presentation of the budget, in which the public hearing is going to be a very quick public hearing. When I say that, there won't be that the front-end staff presentation like we've had. If that tends to run to the 6 o'clock hour, then you'll have that presentation. And you may have citizen comments that provide some different thought that we haven't considered yet for some amount, if any, of that funding moving forward.
So probably at the conclusion of the public hearing is when we would need to finalize where we want those funds allocated, and yes. Then probably recess, and then there would be a
yes.
Get that drafted up. Shane will get to work on that and have it back for us. Okay, thank you. Ruth Pierce.
So, Travis, I have a question. We have asked for public input other than the public hearing on Monday. We've also, on our website, it encourages public input. Other than the reader board comments we've received, have we had any public input that might lead us into what the public wants? Or has it been pretty quiet?
I'm looking at I have not personally heard anything. I was looking at members of the team to see if they had heard anything as individuals, and they have not either.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. However, with that, we will give the opportunity, if there's anyone from the public right now who would like to chime in on the budget, you are more than welcome to approach the podium and do so. As we have done the last 10 weeks. I was going to give it 11, but 10 weeks. Seeing no one clamoring for that, thank you, Travis, for your presentation, and we will have a lively discussion next week. Next on the agenda is public input or items from the city manager and city council. Is there anyone else from the public who would like to address the council this evening? Travis, anything from you, sir?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, right now we are looking at September 6th it's a Tuesday evening following the Labor Day holiday. Right now we do not see, as we're constructing the agenda, as we know we construct these agendas several weeks out, we do not see anything pressing or of significance to cause us to have a meeting. So unless things change at this point in time, we would be looking at canceling the meeting on the 6th. And so we would meet next week. We would not have a meeting on the 6th, and then we would regain our normal meeting schedule following Monday, which is September 12th.
Thank you. Greg Lansing.
And part of that's because of our recently adopting the thing of saying we never have public hearings on holiday weeks, because it makes it hard for people to get into the public hearings, right?
Well, but Labor Day was not one of the holidays, but it just in this case, when we're looking at the number of items, the course of the last few weeks has been some pretty heavy lifting with some of the issues that we have before you. We've really put those forward with a concentration on the budget, and so we just don't have the items of needing critical direction or votes right now.
The other one I would like to talk about is that the Friends of Muni, I realize we changed the name of the golf course, but we didn't change the name of the tournament. Friends of Muni tournament was held several weeks ago where we I represented the council, I guess. I played on the H2M, I guess we don't need the hill anymore, just the H2M Hill team. We didn't win anything, but we had fun. We had a good time with it. Number of teams was down, and we got rid of the golf advisory committee, and that was kind of the committee that ran the tournament, so it kind of just fell to a much smaller group to try to put that together, and so we only got raised $6,000 this year. But if you think about it, it's $6,000 raised by the golfers for their own golf course. So it's almost like they're saying, well, here's another $50 or $100 onto my season pass, and to help the golf course with capital projects. And I saw a huge load of sand that's been dumped into the edge of the parking lot, and I'm pretty sure that's where some of that money went already to refurbish the sand traps, because we tend to, as we hit out of them, we tend to throw the sand out. Sooner or later, you got to put it back in. And then, again, they will continue with what they've been doing in the past with that money is T-box construction, because T-box, they will just wear out. You need to continue refurbishing them, and then additional cart paths, which make the course look better, because then you don't have holes where carts have went through areas that were maybe got wet or those kinds of things. So this year was only $6,000, but it's still $6,000 that is going to be returned to the golf course in the form of capital improvements.
Don Hall.
I have a question for either Jackie or Mitch. I have a citizen, and I realize one citizen a trend does not make, but she contacted me today regarding needing a crosswalk at Addison Maurice for the kids walking home after school. She said high school students. Have we ever looked at that intersection as far as utilization of pedestrians, and if there is a need for maybe painting a crosswalk there? You got it?
I haven't.
Oh, you have. Hi, Jackie.
Hi. I believe that Mike Sullivan has been in contact with this person, because he mentioned today that someone had contacted him about putting a crosswalk somewhere around Maurice.
Okay.
Addison was not what I remembered, but I'll pass it on.
Okay, you'll pass it on?
Sure.
Thank you.
If you would be so kind as to email me this person's name and phone number, yes, Mike does his best work by talking to people about exactly what they're experiencing.
I will do so.
Thanks.
Thank you, Jackie.
Suzanne Hawkins.
Thank you. I would just like to make the public aware that currently our public library has an opening for a trustee on the board of directors. We had one person who had to resign. We also have another member that will be terming out in the near future. And so we would like to get through some interviews now and hopefully get both of those positions filled. So if you're interested in serving on the library board of trustees, they meet once a month on a Wednesday evening. And it's a great group, and get you in touch with the library. You do have to live within city limits.
Thank you, Suzanne. Chris Hawkins.
Well, I spent about a half hour today at the Addison Hankins corner, the D&B corner, and I was quite impressed with the oversized stop signs and the flashing lights, and at least the traffic coming down the hill, the time I saw, was been very walker-friendly. I don't know how we're going to get that resolved with the crosswalks. I think you gave that information to us in your weekly update. But I would really be surprised if there's going to be a lot of foot traffic there. But, Brian, I just wonder if you think it's advisable for us to post a few vehicles at the early morning and the after school at that time, just to make sure if there are walkers that they can safely get across there. I saw no violations of even anybody coming up to the stop sign fast off of the hill, but that's kind of still a little dangerous place. What I'm trying to say is job well done, but we have to have caution there.
Yeah, we can certainly do that. And the other concern I'm hearing, too, is, and this is a conversation for the highway district, is that the portion of that road is 45 miles an hour. So coming from D&B, then you drop down to 35, and so there's a little bit of concern there about the speed. So we've got some things to work out yet.
Thank you.
Anything else from the council? Seeing nothing, we will adjourn.
I want to put this with your collection of fancy printed paper.